On the Union left, the troops there were supposed to have launched the main attack against the Confederate line, but a series of miscommunications had resulted in half-hearted assaults against the position held by Stonewall Jackson. Nevertheless, the Blue troops had broken the famed Confederate's line, but could not follow up on the breakthrough. On the Union right, where attacks were to be made against James Longstreet's line on Marye's Heights, but be more of a distraction as the main thrust was on the left, Edwin Sumner's troops would launch assault after assault against the well-fortified rebels located on the heights. Although Longstreet's corps spread out across four hills, the main thrust by Union forces came at Marye's Heights, occupied by Thomas R. R. Cobb's Georgians and supported by 30 pieces of artillery. Line in front of the Union troops once they marched out of the town was a mill race, which forced the Blue troops to cross at the designated bridges or boards thrown across the waterway. To add to the Federal soldiers' misery, Confederate skirmishers had pulled up many of the planks across the bridges, forcing the Federals to cross on the stringers. This situation made them easy targets for the Confederate artillery perched on the hill in front of them. Parts of Nathan Kimball's and John Andrews' brigades began to cross the bridges across the mill race. The 8th and 4th Ohio and the 1st Delaware came under Confederate long-range artillery fire with shells bursting over their heads, wounding many of their comrades. Once across, they formed into battle lines and awaited the reinforcements promised to them, but as their officers looked around, they could see no support, and to stand still was to court death. So the commander of the 8th Ohio moved out first, followed by the other two regiments toward the hill. One Union soldier stated, "As soon as we rose over the little bank, the missiles came in upon us spitefully, and the air was full of exploding shells." French's men were to pull down any fences or impediments as they moved forward to allow the support units an uninhibited advance. Once the Blue troops came within rifle fire, the Georgians let loose a destructive fire on the 1st Delaware and the 4th Ohio. The 8th Ohio was protected to a certain degree because they were taking cover behind some houses and a blacksmith shop on the Union right. Behind them began to form the rest of Kimball's brigade, the 7th Virginia, 24th New Jersey, 28th New Jersey, and the 14th Indiana. All of those units came under artillery fire once they came into view of the rebel guns. They filed across the mill race regiment by regiment, then formed into battle line for the attack against Cobb's men. The Ohioans and men from Delaware had to pull back to the swale in the middle of the field, where the rebel bullets could not reach them. But this also meant that retreating came with a deadly consequence, so they were stuck there. The rest of Kimball's brigade advanced the swale, but even though he ordered a bayonet charge as he was carried from the field after being wounded in the thigh, the men did not go past where the rest of the brigade remained. Some of the brigade did venture closer to the stone wall, but it was impossible to hold out against so many projectiles flying through the air. Cobb became concerned that his men were burning through ammunition too quickly and sent word to General Robert Ransom about his concern. The North Carolinian, instead of sending ammunition, sent in part of John R. Cook's brigade. Although the Union troops were pinned down, they still delivered volleys from their prone position, enough to make a dent in the North Carolinians until they made it to the safety of the stone wall. A New Jersey soldier wrote, "Every soldier, after firing his piece, had thrown himself flat upon the ground to avoid the enemy's bullets, and I did not see how I could possibly load and fire by laying down in that crouching column of men. To stand up boldly was almost certain death. So continuous was the roar of musketry on the firing line that I do not remember hearing the reports of cannons, but the frightful whiz of heavy missiles passing over our heads every few seconds indicated that the batteries were not silent." Behind Kimball's men came the brigades of John Andrews and Oliver Palmer. Oliver Otis Howard, commander of another division in the Second Corps, was happy to see the 132nd Pennsylvania leave. Some of its members had stolen his breakfast that morning. Andrews' men advanced across the open fields towards the impregnable rebel position. There was a rush, a cheer, a crash of musketry, with a tempest of bullets driven straight at their breasts, and the line dissolved. Palmer's brigade charged behind Andrews' men, but likewise got thrown back. The swale flooded with Blue troops, regiments became entangled, and officers lost track of their men. Many began to risk their lives and retreat back across those open fields to get away from the constant musketry fired at them by Cobb's men. Cobb himself would be wounded about this time, the projectile hitting a main artery in his leg. He would be carried from the field and bleed out. Zook's brigade of Hancock's division of the Second Corps formed on the west side of the mill race. Behind them was the Irish brigade. Zook moved his men out, but the center began to fall behind and the flanks advanced further. His men made it to within rifle range of the Confederates, but the well-protected rebels destroyed Zook's line. The 53rd Pennsylvania did tough it out on the right, however. The Irish Brigade formed up across the Milrays, many of the regiments forsaken the bridge because it was taking too long to cross, and officers told their men to plunge into the frigid water and make it to the other side. They too approached the stone wall, but got cut down. The 69th New York, with two companies detached, went into battle with 168 soldiers. Only 27 returned unharmed. They also fell back, and Caldwell's men formed up to tackle the Confederate line. The 64th and 61st New York had not made it across the Milrace before Hancock rode up to Caldwell and ordered his men to attack because the Irish Brigade was suffering dearly. The brigade moved forward. They collided with Cobb's men. As they exchanged volleys, the 145th Pennsylvania began to falter, but Caldwell rode up to them and rallied the beleaguered troops, and they returned to the front. It did not take long before the Confederate volleys wore on the blue ranks, and Caldwell was forced to pull his men back to the swale. The 64th and 61st New York was ordered by Hancock to extend the line to the right to protect the prone soldiers in the swale. By this point, two divisions had ventured across the open fields and yielded no significant result in their attacks upon the Confederate line. And now, another division of the 2nd Corps, under Oliver Otis Howard, now made their way to the front lines. Generals Howard, Hancock, and Couch met on George Street in Fredericksburg to attempt to make sense of the carnage that their troops were marching into. Part of the discussion focused on the Confederate left and if it could be turned. As the commanders hashed out a plan, more troops were marching into battle. Joshua T. Owen's brigade formed up on the west side of the Milrace, with Owen on foot. His horse had been hit by a shell fragment attempting to cross the waterway. The Confederates shored up their line by sending in Kershaw's brigade of South Carolinians to extend the line to the right and the 25th North Carolina to take the place of the 24th North Carolina, while the latter moved to the left. It was a strong line, made even stronger by the Washington artillery perched atop the heights. Their cannon had destroyed lines of blue troops all morning, and they were going to continue to do so as the day wore on. Owen and his men began their march toward the stone wall, but found that the infantry regiments that he had been sent to support had all remained in the swale. His men could go no further without being destroyed by artillery and rifle fire, so Owen instructed his men to pile up the dead bodies on the crest of the swale to provide more cover from the bullets and other projectiles. Owen, in an attempt to minimize the danger to the rest of his brigade, sent some of his troops from the 69th Pennsylvania to occupy the buildings on the right and use their accurately aimed rifles to damage the rebel line and relieve some of the rest of his men. However, the men from Washington artillery found their range on the building and turned them into a wreck, as one soldier described it. While this was going on, Colonel Norman Hall's brigade formed up to the right and rear of Owen's men. It was about 3 p.m. when Hall's men stepped off. The 19th Massachusetts, preemptive of the order, dashed across the Milrace first. Its ranks got hit by a combination of lead and iron, which drove the men back through the ranks of their comrades. Therefore, when the sister regiments moved, they were late in the advance, and when the 20th Massachusetts and 59th New York made it to within rifle range, the North Carolinians hit them in each flank. Finally, the 19th made it into line, but on the far left, the 7th Michigan, unanchored, took enfilading fire and gave way. This exposed the 42nd New York's flank, and this caused a domino effect, with all the regiments falling back to the swale. The 20th did stubbornly fight, not wanting to give up the ground and risk being shot on withdrawal, but they too were obliged to fall back. Hall, doing as he was instructed to do, rallied his men and attempted another advance. This time it was the New Yorkers in the center who broke first, sending the rest of the line back to the swale to seek cover. In the meantime, the Federal infantry did receive some artillery support, particularly Hazard's battery. The 20th and 19th Massachusetts regiments were the holdouts of Hall's brigade, with the rest moving toward the rear. With Hall and Owen's men pinned down in the swale, Howard committed his last brigade, that under Colonel Sully. Howard actually divided his brigade, sending the 15th Massachusetts to the left and sending the 19th Maine, 34th New York, and 82nd New York to support Hall, with the 1st Minnesota giving aid to an artillery battery. Sully's men could offer little assistance, especially since Howard had divided it. The brigade's rightmost regiments, for the most part, didn't move, but held their position. Their ranks did get withered by the long-range artillery fire and bullets that happened to make it to their lines, but they held on to their position, not daring to go into the swale full of dead, dying, and desperate comrades. However, the 15th Massachusetts on the left did receive brutal volleys from muskets and cannons, which depleted their ranks. The 2nd Corps had been decimated in its attempt to dislodge Longstreet's men, and to the dismay of many Federal troops, two more corps would try their hand at attacking Marye's Heights. Howard's division was not supposed to attack without support, but General Couch was scared that Hancock and French's men would need the reinforcements before his own support could make it to the field. General Orlando Wilcox's 9th Corps was supposed to form up on Howard's left, but the early attack prevented that junction. Now Ferrero's brigade of Sturgis's division of the 9th Corps assembled for its own attack. A soldier from New Hampshire wrote, "The fire in our front was rapidly growing hotter and hotter. The harsh notes of the cannon shook the ground and reverberated among the hills. I could look up to the enemy's works just at our left and see the guns belch forth long sheets of flame and hear the crashing of shells as they struck in our lines." In an attempt to relieve their embattled comrades in the swell, Ferrero's men advanced in splendid style across the field, taking heavy casualties the entire way. When they passed the swell, Owen, part of whose brigade was hunkered down in the swell, attempted to reform his units, but before they could assemble, Ferrero's men were butchered and they fell back to the swell. It was a horrible sight as the gray line behind the stone wall shot out a constant sheet of flame. Ferrero rode to Sturgis and begged him to send more troops to save his brigade. The 51st New York, who had been detached from Ferrero to guard an artillery battery, stepped up to the suicidal task. Despite the grim situation, many were eager to help their fellow comrades. They began their march, meeting the same fate as their comrades, and once they made it to the swell, got pinned down as well, unable to move. James Nagle's brigade was next to enter the fray. He had 2 regiments on the right of the railroad and 3 on the left of it. They dashed across the field, but the leftmost regiments found themselves in an unfinished railroad cut, while the right regiments received debilitating fire from the rebel guns out in the open. Nagle went over to the 3 units and ordered them out of the cut, but the majority would not move from their safe position. The 7th Rhode Island and the 6th New Hampshire took a heavy cannonading as they attempted to cross a fence, and once they reached the swell, came under devastating volleys of musketry and were obliged to lie down with the rest of the troops. The 6th was staying somewhat together, so Nagle again tried to pry his men from the railroad cut. The 9th New Hampshire and the 12th Rhode Island followed orders and came out of their hiding place, but the hail of lead brought the units to a standstill within 100 feet of the stone wall. The men trickled back to the swell, some running the chance of getting shot in the back or running all the way back to the town. On the Confederate side, the 3rd South Carolina Battalion moved across Hazel Run in order to fire on the blue troops hunkered down in the railroad cut. The Union 2nd Corps and part of the 9th had tried and failed to dislodge the Confederates, but as fighting had died down on the Union left, Ambrose Burnside wanted to make another effort against the Gray Line. He ordered in part of Daniel Butterfield's 5th Corps to attack the stone wall. Barnes' brigade of Griffin's division of that corps formed up outside of the town. A strange order came to the commander of the 18th Massachusetts that he may charge if he wanted to. Its commander saw the fruitless efforts of other regiments and declined to, but through a series of aides carrying orders to the regiment, it was ordered to charge by itself, getting hit by musketry and artillery fire, who found the lonely regiment too appetizing not to fire upon it. It fell back quickly to the safety of the town. The rest of Barnes' men conducted a wheeling motion to cross the railroad track, then wheeled the other way to make their way up to the open fields toward the stone wall. The 2nd Maine, who had entered the unfinished railroad cut, did not move from their position, while the rest made it to the swell and again got pinned down. The 118th Pennsylvania sprinted for the rear, but they were not alone for long. The rest of Barnes' men pulled back to safety, and some remained in the swell, too afraid to leave. Behind them was the brigade of Jacob Schweitzer, a Pennsylvania-born gentleman of German ancestry. He was a lawyer before the war, but had rose through the ranks fairly quickly. He formed his brigade in 2 lines, and as they got closer to the swell, a rush of soldiers exited the swell, headed for the rear, and broke up the integrity of his lines. The chaotic nature of the retreating blue troops caused the 62nd Pennsylvania to waver and break apart. Schweitzer had to quickly reassemble them. Also making things more complicated for him was that Carroll's brigade of the 3rd Corps moved onto the field. Their battle lines collided into one another, causing communication problems and formations broke down. Carroll ultimately pulled his men back to the railroad cut from whence they came. Schweitzer's men finally made it to the swell. Determined to carry out his orders and break the Confederate line, Schweitzer found a Second Corps officer still in the swell and suggested that they all move toward the stone wall. But there was no moving the blue troops. But the officer took Schweitzer to the left of the line and pointed him toward the end of the stone wall and told him that that would be the place to attack. Schweitzer mounted on his horse, stuck his sword through his hat, and led his men to the left. His horse was shot out from under him, and he received a nasty leg wound. Nevertheless, his men attempted to advance, but the withering fire from the rebels prevented them from advancing too far, and they fell back. Behind them was Carroll's men. They fixed bayonets and stormed over the railroad cut. Once they made it to the swell, they geared themselves up for the advance to the stone wall. With a yell, the brigade streamed over the crest and charged up to the wall. They could not withstand the volleys unprotected and pulled back. General Joseph Hooker, appalled at the scenes of carnage playing out on the slopes of Mary's Heights, rode to Burnside and begged him to call off any further attacks, but the army commander was determined to break the Confederate line at the stone wall. It was around 4:30 p.m. when the brigade of Colonel Stockton and two brigades of Humphreys' division formed up outside the town of Fredericksburg. On the Union left, Stockton ordered a bugle call for his brigade to move, but the 17th and 12th New York did not hear the call and stayed put, while the other four regiments moved. However, the 20th Maine and the 44th New York got slowed down by fences in their way. The 83rd Pennsylvania and the 16th Michigan made it to the swell first and moved to the left to help protect the men in the swell, but it only exposed their flank, which got raked with lead from Kershaw's South Carolinians. The 20th Maine and 44th New York made it into the swell as well. They exchanged musketry with the rebels, but had to find protection along with the rest of the demoralized blue troops. Lagging far behind, 12th and 17th New York finally made it into the swell, but their numbers did little to help the situation. On the right, Humphreys' men, divided by a road, prepared for their advance. In one of the most heroic displays of the war, General Humphreys rode in front of his division to lead it as to inspire his men who had just witnessed numerous regiments fail to take the position. Allaback's brigade moved out first with their division commander encouraging them every step of the way. They made it into the swell and Humphreys was able to convince them to advance against the Confederates. They exchanged musketry with Phillips' Legion until Humphreys' horse was shot out from under him. He began cussing the rebels for killing his $1,700 horse and then borrowed another one to ride to Tyler's brigade and personally lead it into battle. Allaback's men settled into a prone yet somewhat protected location in front of the stone wall, returning fire when possible. Tyler's men advanced without firing a shot by order of Humphreys, who realized that rifle fire did little to damage the Confederate line. He wanted his men to use the bayonet. However, Tyler's men disobeyed orders once they got to within rifle range of the stone wall and stopped to fire. The momentum was gone, and the lead flew from the rebel guns. Tyler and his men had to fall back along with Allaback's men. Darkness was starting to cover the battlefield, and Burnside had still not dislodged the Confederates from Mary's Heights, so he committed parts of two more divisions, those under George Sykes and George Getty. Sykes formed up across the mill race, but never received orders to advance. Getty, on the other hand, did. Hawkins' brigade attacked the rebels from the south. The 10th New Hampshire, at first, did not move out with the rest of the brigade because of a miscommunication, but caught up to the rest of the regiments. The 25th New Jersey broke in two, with the right side advancing further. The 13th Rhode Island sandwiched themselves between the two halves of the 25th New Jersey. By the time the blue troops made their advance, it was fairly dark, so much so that neither side could see each other. Nevertheless, the South Carolinians fired volleys into the darkness, and the chaos from the musketry forced Hawkins back. The day ended with one of the most brutally lopsided battles of the American Civil War. The scene on the slopes and in the swell horrified veterans of the battle until their death, and many never forgave Burnside for ordering those attacks. Many soldiers described it as simply murder.